course is titled Karachi from Stone Age to Cyber Age, and our panelists include Mr. Arif Hassan, Mr. Taimur Suri, Kalimul Alashari, Asma Ibrahim, and Rumana Hussain, and Ms. Aisha Umar. And this will be this program will be moderated by Alia Iqbal Naqvi, who holds a PhD from Harvard and has a focus in Indo-Muslim civilization.
Thank you. We're here to talk about Karachi today and the importance of studying Karachi in depth, of archiving whatever information that we have, towards which end all of us present in front of you today, with two members missing, Meher Noshirvani and Dr. Hassan Ali Khan, came together some time ago and held a Karachi conference last year in November at the Arts Council. There were several reasons for holding such a conference. We all felt, and I think many people agreed since the conference was well received, that the city is looked at in a very two-dimensional geopolitical lens. We focus a lot on violence and politics and not enough on the really critical challenges that are faced by an urban megapolis like Karachi. If any of you read Arif Hassan's piece in the Tribune yesterday, Karachi is, by all statistical accounts, the fastest growing city in the world. In 1998, the city was reputed to have a population of 9.8 million, and by 2011, it has a population of 21.2 million, which is what makes it the fastest growing city in the world in so short a time. So you can only imagine the planning challenges. In addition to that, we have a lot of historians amongst us. Taimur Suri studies the history of visual culture. Lashari Saab studies cultural and literary history. Dr. Asma is an archaeologist. And I think many of you will be surprised to hear, as I was, that the history of this region actually stretches back to Neolithic times. We're used to thinking of Karachi as a very young city, which, of course, in many ways it is, but the area has been populated for a lot longer, and our roots go deep. I think perhaps I'll begin with Dr. Asma, who is the president of the Karachi Conference Foundation. She will tell us a little bit about why we actually decided to have this conference, and something about her work. She does absolutely fascinating things. Right now, she is heading an archaeological commission in Bhambur, where they have unearthed layers up to the first century BC. She's working in collaboration with an archaeological commission from Italy and France, and presented a really fascinating paper on the prehistory of Karachi during the Karachi conference. Dr. Asma, over to you.
Rumana, I just wanted to introduce you. Rumana is left, so you should introduce. Okay. Okay. Assalamu alaikum, ladies and gentlemen. And thank you very much, Alia, for my introduction. I would like to give you a brief about how the concept of Karachi conference began initially. Initially, we planned a very small-scale conference about Parsis in Karachi, and that idea was conceived by Hassan Ali, who is not present today, and Arif Hassan Sahab. So we worked for that conference. Almost everything was done. And then at the end of it, like when we were nearly about to launch the conference, we came to know that this community doesn't feel secure, and they just backed out. And we were just shocked, and we didn't know what to do, how to now go about it. Then Dr. Kalimullah Ashari and Arif Hasan sahab came with the idea that why not we do a conference on Karachi, which is much required. So it should be overall Karachi, not only one community. So we started working in that direction. And being archaeologists and historians and all my other friends, me basically, because I was an archaeologist and I've been working on Stone Age history of Karachi from my studentship, that was from 1986. So I wanted to bring up this issue that why Karachi's archaeology is neglected. And I have never come across anybody who knew that we have history of Karachi dating back to 2 million years ago. And I wanted to bring up this issue. So I thought that we thought that we should have a conference starting from very early history of Karachi. Let me give you a brief about the objectives of the conference. This conference took a form, actually a body that is dedicated to be there and constantly avail a platform to discuss the matters pertaining to Karachi into development, its issues, its past, its present and its future. The members of the foundation wanted to create a forum that is not just a passing phase, but to avail the opportunities to the academicians, intellectuals, scholars, thinkers, and students perpetually. Luckily, the idea of a seminar on Karachi didn't fare well with the core group. We had a conference last year that wanted to have a forum that may eagerly learn discourse to start, that shall remain open to ideas, provide chance for academic debate and a discussion that may further invite focus to some specific issues as well. It is too much to say at this occasion, as the initiatives are sometimes not durable enough. History tells us that some wonderful work has been done in the past and it has denied continuity, and we all are aware of this fact as well. The forum is there. It is for you, and we are there for the cause of exposition of all the finer elements, for all the criticism, for planning and providing the constant forum. May it not be the occasion of the annual conference, still you have got your ideas to come fluttering like a butterfly, and it shall be received well. The members of the executive committee, core group, have really worked hard and devoted considerable time for its foundation. They deserve duly to be acknowledged for this hard work and commitment, and they're all sitting with us except Meher Noshirwani and Hassan Ali, who was actually the person behind this idea. I'm availed this proud position by my colleagues, and I'm thankful to them for sharing this conference confidence on me. Okay, about the first conference, Karachi conference. It was unique in the sense that it was thematic chronologically. Starting from history of Karachi from 2 million years ago, Buddhist remains in Karachi, start of the physical boundaries of Karachi from early historic period, presence of Jews, political, social and art historians, plus contemporary issues of identity, etc., were discussed in the conference at length. An interrupted history of Karachi from early Stone Age to middle and then upper Stone Age. So early Stone Age starts from 2 million years ago, and we discussed it up to Neolithic period, which is 10,000 BC. So it just didn't end it there. There is a continuous sequence of from Stone Age to historic period, and that's what I discussed. And after Neolithic site, we have protohistoric sites, which are like Indus Valley sites, early to Indus Valley sites, are present actually in Karachi. And I discussed that, and we showed slides and the material we discovered. From its peculiar position, the area of Karachi was a hub of different cultures from very early times. Although a lot of archaeological surveys have been carried out from 1800s onwards by Pakistani and foreign scholars, but this area is blank on archaeological map, and which is very, very sad. I mean, if you go through Google, if you go through historic or archaeological records, you will never see Karachi's archaeology. The Stone Age sites are disappearing very quickly, and that was one of my main concerns. And one of the major shock which I had was when I asked Karachi University Geography Department to let me see the collection again, because after 1986 I couldn't work on it. So the Geography Department refused completely from the Karachi University, and they said, we will not allow you the access to this collection. So I wanted to this issue also to the forum of intellectuals and scholars of Karachi, that we should all join hands and we should work for this archaeological treasure which we have. Then megaliths are disappearing very quickly. Maybe a lot of people, you know, may not know that we had megalithic sites in Karachi. They were in Gulistan and Johor. So they have all disappeared. So that was another thing which we brought up in the conference. Large number of sites in the area of Karachi University, Liari, Sharif Faisal and Malir have gone and disappearing very quickly again. And then from Stone Age, one traces the sites of protohistory of Indus Valley in the area of Malir Nadi. We actually have four huge protohistoric Indus Valley sites in the area of Malir Nadi and Liari, which are there, and anybody wants to visit. The main site which I would give you a brief about is the Aladino site, which is a protohistoric site that is pre-Indus. And when Walter Fair Service, who was an American archaeologist, he started digging in 1975 at the site of Aladino, he never had an idea that what a great treasure he's going to face and he's going to explore. He started excavation in 1975 and he went away, then he came back in 1976. After the rains, the soil was cleared away and he could see the glint of the gold from the earth. So being a senior archaeologist, he realized that he's going to have a great treasure. So he sent all the laborers for holiday and he dug up this big pot and he took it to Hotel Metropole where he was staying. There he cleared this pot and he took out the jewelry. And there was this gold jewelry, carnelian beads, which were very, very rare. He took out all those. And we don't know. There is a saying that there were four pots, but we came to have that treasure from only one pot. But that still is one of the world's rarest collection, one can say. And it is lying down with the exploration branch in Karachi, Department of Archaeology. The jar had a massive belt of 36 long carnelian beads and bronze spacer. Only three such belts have been discovered in the world. So you can imagine the area of Karachi, how rich it was, and it was a hub of these kind of civilizations. There were silver necklaces, silver rings, spacers. Then we have three more sites in the area of Karachi which are protohistoric, pre-Indus, I mean. Peer Shah Jhurio, Hassan Wali, and in the area of Orangi, and perennial of Hub River between Karachi and Las Pela. So these are the sites which are still there. And then after protohistoric, I left the floor for my other colleague who discussed the Buddhist remains in Karachi. So that is how we trace the history from history of Karachi, not from Kolachi, but Karachi is actually a Stone Age site and where hunter-gatherers were living. They had beautiful polished tools. I wish I knew that there was a PowerPoint so I could bring the slides and show it to you. So they were beautiful polished stone tools and which turned into the bronze tools. So we can see the whole evolution, how these people have evolved and became civilized. So Karachi is not what we see today. So this was one of the major ideas behind the conference. At the moment, I'm working at Bhambor, which is an Islamic site, and most of you must have visited there. So I'm heading the Pakistan Archaeological Mission. The main objective, as you might know, that there were excavations of Department of Archaeology from 1958 to 1965. For 7 years or 8 years, Department of Archaeology was excavating. But it was not done scientifically. So we thought that we should document this site, as nowadays, you know, archaeology is more than a romantic field. Initially, it used to be taken as a romantic subject, but now it's more scientific. So we are working on the scientific basis. We are documenting the site, we are re-excavating, and we are going to compare the results of this excavation with the previous results, which were not documented properly. So next year, May I tell you one or two to future plans of the Karachi conference, and if somebody wants to discuss our work at Bhambor, I don't want to take much time because my other colleagues must discuss their work as well. So our future plans of the Karachi conference this year would be an event on stories of Lyari's oral history. We feel that it is disappearing very quickly, so we are going to record the oral history of Lyari and publication of the papers from previous year, and organizing this year's conference and exhibition on Karachi. So I may hand over the floor to my other colleagues and they can discuss, and you can always come back to me. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Asma. That was a great summation. I think I'd like to move on to Dr. Kalimullah Lashari, since we seem to be following a somewhat chronological order, and we have named Roman. Given our session the name of Karachi Stone Age to Cyber Age. Dr. Lashari has enjoyed a parallel career as a civil servant and an academic, and he is responsible for a lot of the heritage and preservation projects around Karachi and Sindh. He was a moving force behind the establishment of the Department of Antiquities in Sindh. And he is also a founder member of the Center for Archaeological and Environmental Research, an organization for conservation projects, and the only one of its kind to have a conservation lab, documentation center, and library to facilitate scholars and students of history and archaeology. He studies the cultural and literary history of Sindh, amongst many other things. I think, Dr. Lashari, I would specifically like you to address the question of why we have decided this year to hold, to focus on Lyari and its stories, and also to talk a little bit about one of the most important initiatives that we are trying to push forward, which is a Karachi museum.
Thank you, Alia, and Assalamu alaikum. When we talk about Karachi, Karachi has its history, which is very recent. If we go by the urban settlement of this place. So leaving behind the prehistoric presence of human activity, a lot of which has been detailed by Dr. Asma, and I myself may go beyond this perspective and talk about the present day Karachi and its emergence. As we all know that Karachi was the amalgam of so many villages which were present all along these rainy streams and also on the coastal fringes. People were mostly living on the livestock, and the things were happening with the maritime activity, but not on the larger scale. Because the larger maritime centers like Debal was again the periphery of the kings. It was with the princes. So what Karachi was, there's no such mention. When we look into the books of history, Sevan is mentioned, Debal is mentioned, Neruncourt is mentioned. So where is Karachi? So we construe that any area which is away from Neruncourt and away from Debal and away from Kaikan, away from Sevan is Karachi. This is the area which is enclosed by, on the one hand, the Kirthar, and on the other hand, the sea. So this sea, the interior Kohistan of Thatta and Dadu, and the mountains of Kirthar. On the other side, we have the mentions of Armabil and Gadrosia. So Makran is present there. So it is mentioned in the histories. But nobody has ever mentioned the area, the region, which is now comprising Karachi itself and its larger peripheries. But going beyond this will be actually defeating the remark where Alia wanted us to speak about, was that the Lyari itself has acquired in today's scene a sort of notoriety which is a factor that we should focus more on this area and try to see what Lyari has, what sort of place in the history of Karachi. Lyari being the old continuation of the colonial period Trans-Lyari quarters, the city quarters which were named as Trans-Lyari quarters, is basically today we call it Lyari. This is on the banks of the river Lyari, and its settlement started very soon once we have the social changes accruing in Balochistan. What happens in Balochistan is that there were smaller states. Foremost of these were the state of Makran and the state of Lasbin. If anything happened there, so its total repercussions were felt in Karachi city, which was at that time under the colonial period emerging, and there were so many chances of earning livelihood, activity, economy was starting to flourish, and the city life was organized by the colonialist in a manner that more activity was possible. So these were the times when the Trans-Lyari quarters started attracting so many people. When the slavery was banned under the British pressure in the state of Makran, so many people got free. So the natural result was that once you are no more a bonded person, you lose two things. You lose your chains and you lose your earnings. There was nothing for them to live on. The old masters got themselves free and the slaves got their freedom. So nobody was paying for their food. So these slaves had to move somewhere, and many of them moved to the Sindh and many stayed in Lyari. Besides that, whatever was happening in Iran, so the Baloch had the presence of at least 10 centuries movement coming down to Sindh through Makran and also Lasbela and going back, rerouting themselves again with the mountain. They went up to the Larkana through the Kirthar range. So these Baloch were also then very much attracted to the prospects of economic activity, and they also settled in the Lyari area. So Lyari's person, and we in our early days of school used to call them Makrani. We never thought that there are two types of people, colored people, coming from Africa, but we had the total label of calling them Makrani. The background is that the slave trade was gone, and these people were free because of the social changes in Balochistan, and they were free to go anywhere, free to earn their livelihood in a new manner. So the Lyari started getting more people, started getting more living quarters. Initially, 1874-75 surveys show us that most of the godowns were present in the Lyari, Trans-Lyari quarters. Now these godowns were turned into the residential quarters, and this was the time when these vibrant people started having a look which was leading them to look inside, look within their own resources. And this was the time that so many educational institutions came up. And these were basically all sponsored by the people who were associated with Lyari and the economic activity within the Lyari quarters. Now these, most of those schools and colleges are nationalized, and they have lost touch with the local tradition and the local people. This is the reason that the education in Lyari has experienced a great setback. And then these people, when they actually were there, they started locating and relocating themselves and their relatives, because the presence of Baloch in this area, as I was briefly mentioning, has been associated with the last millennia. But their coming and going was not as much sort of sedentary, because at particular moment there was no economic means available in Karachi to make people live and settle down there. Less drinking water. The Karachi's arid area, as we all know, that it was through the colonial efforts that the water supply came to Karachi. So this was one reason. And then at that particular moment, not a very extensive agricultural activity was there. Karachi had very few agricultural farms, and those were dependent upon the wells. And these wells were getting their water supply through the rains, which were again not sufficient. So this area could not sustain in the past population more than a few thousand people. So this was the reason that these Balochis kept coming and going back to Balochistan. So, but their association with the area remained. And their association with the area is reflected throughout all those graveyards, which we so famously call Chokandi graves. So these Chokandi graveyards are with us since 500 years. And they have been building these sort of tombs up to the turn of the 20th century. So this continuous sort of activity denotes their connection with this region, but they were not fully settling here till they started getting the more stable economic facility which arose within the area. So the Layari has still preserved the memories of those days when they used to come, stay and go back, and then they started identifying this area with themselves, and then they started paying their whole heart and soul into this region and building it in a way that it became the finest living quarters of Karachi, with a vibrant population which was fully involved, devoted and contributing towards the development of its economy. So this is the reason that this year we are planning to have an activity within the Layari, and we'll be going there and asking the Layariites to come out and tell us the story of their settlement within this region, the story how they socially came up to this level, how they economically built their own system, and how they are presently being made to suffer because of certain elements which have their targets which may not be very noble. Thank you.
Lashari Sahib, museum ki baat reh gayi, but we'll come back to that because we are now getting tight on time. I'm going to move on to Rumana Hussain, sitting next to me, who doesn't require much introduction. She's a Karachi-based educator, writer, illustrator, and is probably present in many of our homes, either in the form of her wonderful book, Karachi Wala, or the many fantastic children's books she has produced over the years. Karachi Wala is subtitled A Subcontinent Within a City, and I really think a truer description of Karachi is, you know, that is a very true description of Karachi. It's not even a microcosm of the country, because communities that don't exist anywhere else or haven't settled anywhere else in Pakistan live in Karachi, and languages that aren't spoken anywhere else in the country are spoken in Karachi. Rumana, I'd love for you to talk about what brought you to the Karachi conference, what you think its importance is, and especially in light of the work you did putting together the book Karachi Wala.
Well, Arif Hassan brought me to the Karachi conference, basically. You know, he has been an old friend, and since my husband is also an architect, so, you know, we've been talking to him for the last almost 35 years about Karachi and its growth and problems and so on. But, my main work has always been with children, for children, and you spoke about the children's books. So,
Many years ago, amongst other books of stories, I also did a children's book on Karachi. It was in Urdu, like most of my children's books are. Lately, I've been doing bilingual children's books as well, but this was in Urdu. And a small book, but you know, the history of Karachi. I wish I had met Dr. Asma and Dr. Lashari more than 20 years ago. Then, you know, perhaps I could have also started that book, writing the history, yes, in a different, you know, a different way. But anyway, so I think, you know, day before yesterday when I had the session on my book Karachi Wala, I spoke about this, that basically I always felt that there was this huge variety of people who live in this city. There is such a rich diversity, and why don't we document that, or why don't we talk about it? Because in you know, the school textbooks, we haven't really progressed, we haven't moved, we still talk about the same, you know, four or five communities that exist in Karachi, because we that's the political boundaries that we have, you know, the provinces, and we only talk about that. And therefore my interest in people, because I've been writing for the papers, I've been interviewing people, whether they are performing artists or visual artists, and my background is in art. I trained as a graphic designer. So you spoke about the illustrations, so that too is because, you know, I thought I could delve in that. And therefore I just felt that going to each of these homes, there are 64 stories in the book, and I would say roughly about 40 different communities are covered, although I have still not covered them all. There are many more that were left. And it just was a very learning experience, because although based in Karachi, born in Karachi, but you know, we just don't know enough about each other, which reminds me of the keynote speech of Dr. Rajmohan Gandhi the other day. That, you know, overnight we became each, you know, that there was this relationship that was formed. And we did, even the Pakistanis, they don't know the other Pakistanis. So I think, which is very true. And we have not really made that effort. We don't teach our children that so many wonderful people exist in this very city, and to know their them, to know their lifestyles, to know where they have come from, to know what traditions they are still following, what rituals they are still, you know, practicing. I think if we know enough about each other, then much of the misunderstandings will disappear. Much of the strife will be probably, you know, we will not have this much strife and disregard and disrespect of the other. Because my book, in a way, I have tried to show a mirror to ourselves that, look, we are all different, even within the Muslim communities. It is not a monolithic, you know, kind of, there's so many differences, and there needs to be a celebration of these differences. I also felt like Dr. Asma spoke about how the Karachi conference began, and our focus, you know, we wanted to focus on the Parsi community and have a conference on that. So while I was doing my book, I felt that there were some communities who felt so insecure that they did not want themselves to be included, which is again such a shame and such a big loss. But I think it is understandable because we are so intolerant, and we are it's proven over the years, so you know, one can't blame them. But nevertheless, I was I think just going into people's homes and covering right from the poor homes to the rich homes, middle class, and across the, you know, length and breadth of the city, I think that book just gave me personally a lot more than I could put out in the book, because I learned a lot from that. Thank you.
Thank you, Rumana. 40 different communities you covered, and that wasn't all. That's a fairly startling number.
Yes, in 64 stories, yes.
In our conference statement for the Karachi conference, one of our main goals is to celebrate this cultural mosaic that is Karachi and that Rumana just talked about. But moving on, I think, to somewhat more dire and depressing things. Arif Sahab, who requires no introduction, he's the recipient of the Hilal-e-Imtiaz, a founding member of the Asian Coalition of Housing Rights, of the Urangi Pilot Project, of the Urban Resource Center. He writes regularly in newspapers, he has books, he has a fantastic website, which you should all look at when you leave this room, documenting so much about the history of Karachi. Arif Sahab, I'd like to invite you to talk about your more recent work on the demographic changes in Karachi and the planning challenges that they pose.
It will take too long. Mm-hmm. So why don't you just visit the website? Most of it is on the website. It's Arif Hasan, ARIFHASAN. .org and
thoda sa
sabko dara to dijiye na nahi darane ki to koi baat hi nahi hai isme sheharon ke sath to ye cheeze hoti rehti hain dekhen let me just sum it up for you. If the pre census house count is correct, then the city's population has increased at a rate of 8.1% from 1998 till 2011, if it is correct. People doubt that it's correct, but anyway, if it is correct. The house number of people per household has increased by 10% since 1998. This has not happened anywhere in Pakistan except in Karachi. And the reason for this increase is not that fertility rates have gone up, it is simply that people do not have accommodation. They have nowhere to live. Recently, we brought out a number of studies with my colleagues at the NAD University on how settlement patterns are changing in Karachi. And the link of transport that is influencing that change. The age of Kachi Abadis, of friendly neighborhoods, is history. And I think the sooner the planners of this city realize that, the better. The reason is that it is cheaper to rent in the city as a poor person than own a house on the periphery. Transport is expensive, can't afford it. It takes too long to commute. The father never sees his children. The woman can't go to work because it's too far away now, because the work is in the city. So there are numerous studies which you will find on my website documenting how this influences settlement patterns. To cater to the need for habitation, the Kachi Abadis and low-income groups are going up, settlements are going up. Let's take Layari. It was the first project I worked with in 1993 with Ghulam Kibria. At that time, the density of Layari was 280 persons per hectare. Today it is more than 4,000 persons per hectare. And it's not livable. And most of these settlements are becoming like that. If you talk to the women in these settlements, we have numerous interviews. They say, pehle theek tha, bachchon ki dekhbhal kar sakte the, ab bachchon ki dekhbhal nahi kar sakte. Wo gangs bana lete hain, wo drugs lena shuru kar dete hain, pehle theek tha. You talk to the old people, wo kehte hain ki hum upar se 6-7 manzil se niche nahi aa sakte, kai kai mahine yahan baithe rehte hain. The size of the unit becomes smaller and smaller to make it affordable. Consequently, you have 10 to 12 people living in apartments of two rooms, sometimes one room. So that gives greater freedom to the younger generation. Bahar nikal jate hain, both men and women. So we have documented all this through a lot of surveys. And then because we have had a presence, I mean, since 1971, I've worked in these settlements, and then with Akhtar Hamid Khan since 1981. These settlements are not the settlements in which I started working in 1971 or even in 1981. They are totally different settlements. Sociology is different. Lifestyles are different. They have beauty parlors in them. They have marriage halls. They have community centers. They have conflict because the extended family is gone. The clan-based settlement has been substituted by settlements that are owned and possessed by politicians. So it's a very different world. And what has happened as a result of all this is that you are living in, when you talk of Karachi, for me, it is four distinct cities which have nothing to do with each other. You have the central business district and the proletariat that serves it, which is the markets and the proletariat that serves it, dominated by Gujarati-speaking businessmen and small traders. This is your one city. Your other city is what I call the inner crescent. Gulistan-e-Johar, Gulshan-e-Iqbal, Nazimabad, Federal Bay Area, dominated by Urdu speakers, with increasing pockets of the Sindhi middle class establishing themselves in these pockets. And some very fast disappearing Sindhi and Baloch goats in this area. Then you have the outer crescent, which consists of expanding informal settlements, very different in nature from the inner crescent. Over the years, they have become ethnically divided, which they were not when I started working in 1971 or even up to the early 90s. But now they're very much ethnically divided. Lots of no-go areas, lots of ideologies. And then you have Clifton and Defense and the society's area. These four areas have different modes of transport. They have different systems of education. They speak different languages, and they have nothing to do with each other. Just to see how much they know of each other, we carried out a survey of 1,000 people from different classes to find out if they knew about the names of locations. They didn't. The best informed was the inner crescent, which knew almost everything. The worst informed were the Defense and Clifton lot, who didn't know anything. And then after them, there were the outer settlements, the outer crescent. They were also completely uninformed. The only area where they meet is Sea View, is the Clifton Beach. Apart from that, there is no meeting ground. Now, I can go on to explain how these settlements function, who does what, but that'll take a long time. It's all there on the web. I've put everything I had on it, including the books. So you're welcome to it.
More than that,
just you know. Just one minute. Can I? Just about the Karachi conference. You know, the idea was essentially to bring people of very different backgrounds together. The archaeologists talk to archaeologists, the conservationists talk to conservationists, the planners talk to planners, the artists talk to artists, and nobody talks to the activists that actually run the city and manage the city. So the idea was to bring them all together, including the activists. And I think in the conference we managed to do that. And there is also, I always tell my friend, both my friends as a matter of fact, because since I've studied the old city in considerable detail, since it was created in its present form, it really began in 1729. That date is very firm. But it is on a mound. It's the only mound in that entire flat area. I always say that there is a settlement underneath this. And I always say that because very on the fringes of that settlement in the old town quarters, you have four shrines that date back 14th century, 15th century, and 17th century. So if there was no settlement there, why were these shrines there? I mean, that's a question I ask. Maybe Dashaji Sahab can answer it. And also, you have tradition here among the various communities about their mandars, and they date them. There is a tradition that they were old mandars, and they are all on mounds, by the way. So my theory is that the tradition is probably true, and under those mounds, there are the remains of the earlier mandars. Thank you.
Another important element which actually made the first conference as successful as we think it was, is that we had a diverse and engaged audience. So I think for more of all of this, we hope you will support it and come to the next Karachi conference. We're running out of time, so unfortunately I cannot pass the mic on to my colleagues Taimur Suri and Aisha Umar. Or perhaps you can take a minute each to just explain what you work on, since you two are holding up the cyber age part of our title.
I think we should allow Aisha to speak first, because she's the youngest member of our group, very enthusiastic about the city, and a completely different viewpoint from all of us, from Arif Saab, Lashari Saab, Rumana, Asma, myself, and I think we'll give her some time, if we've only got a short amount of time left.
Aisha is a performance artist, an activist, and actually I would call her a budding cultural anthropologist as well, because she really studies and looks at how ordinary people resist social injustice, and has also, amongst other things, has participated and organized public performances and social media campaigns along these lines.
Thank you so much. It's a real privilege to work with this group of esteemed intellectuals, activists, scholars. Har din kuch seekhne ko milta hai, and for that I'm truly grateful. Thank you, Taimur, as well for giving me this time. I'll be very brief. So as Alia mentioned, I do performance work, but I also have recently started research on the Hazara Shia protests that happened in Pakistan last year, and we saw some at the beginning of this year as well. I thought that they were phenomenal in terms of nationwide protest, social mobilizations in solidarity with a group of marginalized community that's, you know, was sitting out with their dead loved ones in Quetta, far away from us all. And I thought that was a fantastic phenomena to research. As a young scholar working with these incredible individuals, I've learned to also look at, to focus my attention towards Karachi, and I'm increasingly interested in looking at stories, that are accounts of people remembering their loved ones who they lost to brutal violence, and what that memory does in terms of provoking or producing a resistance to that violence. But that's all.
Succinctly and nicely put, Aisha. I'm sure the audience has lots of questions, so I think we'll move to you. But I want to ask the first question since I have the mic in hand. This is addressed to Dr. Asma, Arif Saab, and Dr. Lashari. Can we share with our audience what the plans for a Karachi museum so far are?
So this is now my privilege to tell and share with the people that how this idea of Karachi Museum was coming to our mind, and we decided to at least get hold of this idea, present it to the people, and then go ahead with the establishment of one such museum for Karachi. Karachi, as we all know, that since the inception of the colonial rule, it started its own museum in the year just immediately after the annexation in the year 1845. This museum was exactly located by the side where we have this Baloch Maze on the Elphinstone Street. And this small scale museum was then shifted to the Ferrer Hall once the Ferrer Hall came into being, and it was in the 1856. This museum continued to work till the time we acquired our own dedicated building of a museum, that is the present Supreme Court registry. This building was built as a Victoria Museum for Karachi, and this museum was a very large scale museum comprising of a collection which was so varied that it contained the material which was ethnological, archaeological, art and artifacts. Besides that, a huge zoological botany related exhibits were also there. So it was sort of the initiation of some branches of natural history to be displayed in that particular museum. And then when Pakistan came into existence, the federal orders were brought in so that the buildings were required for the secretariat. The central government had no accommodation of its own. The provincial government has its sort of accommodation, and the provincial assembly was taken over as the national assembly. So then the shift moved. This building, Victoria Museum building, was then vacated, and the museum shifted again back to the Ferrer Hall. Now, this museum, last touch of the Karachi. From that time onwards, the museum which was shifted to the Ferrer Hall was named as National Museum of Pakistan. So the branching of the ways, the parting of the ways, actually now compel us to go and get back the museum for Karachi. And how possibly we can get back the museum of Karachi? There are two ways. There's one legal struggle to be initiated, asking the persons who are at the realm of affairs that please give back our building. So enough is enough. You had the chance to be there, sit in Supreme Magistracy and enjoy the relishes of a building which was a dedicated building for a museum. So this is the time when you talk about the rights. You talk about the rights of the different organs of a state to be right there in their own place, occupy their own space. And so this is the time that the museum should be given back its building. Second aspect is that, well, if the powers, they don't feel like moving out of that building and are least interested in the aspirations of the people, then the people do have their own will. And I do understand that under the leadership of Karachi Conference Foundation, we are there to initiate a full-fledged scheme of things for which we are making the outlines. And sooner we are going to disclose this whole project. We'll bring it back to the Karachi city people, that your city came into existence much, much earlier than the imaginations of the popular imagination, but then it had its varied presence, and it is through the lots of labor of love by humans which made it possible and brought it to this day. So these variations of its existence are to be depicted in one place, and that one place will be the Karachi Museum.
Dr. Saab, do we have a minute for some questions or no? All right. Any questions from the audience? The gentleman back there.
I've been out of the country for 36, 37 years. But I've been coming every year. I was not born here. I'm old enough. I was born pre-partition. But my good memories are from that time. And in 1960s, there was some Mushaira in which some Shair put, he was only mentioning about the India, but I include all the history which Mr. Ashari gave, ke itne shahar bikharte hain, to ek Karachi banta hai. Meri tragedy ye hai ki us Karachi ka करूंगा जो इसमें है, अगर उसी को इम्प्रूव करवा दें, एक ट्रांसपोर्ट सिस्टम मैंने दिल्ली का देखा है बनते हुए और उसको इम्प्रूव होते हुए, वन ऑफ द फाइनेस्ट इन द वर्ल्ड, पीपल मे नॉट लाइक बट पीपल फ्रॉम सब कॉन्टिनेंट कैन लिव विद दैट। दूसरा जो है ड्रेनेज सिस्टम, मैं यहां आखिरी बार आया, 1/10 of an inch ब्लॉक द होल एंड सीन। While you want to compare the twin city like Karachi is Bombay, about 5-6 years ago, there was 36 inches of rain in one day. I happened to visit that city after 3 days, the entire thing is worked. So my request is this, can we do anything as a conference here? And for Mr. Dr. Lashari, there's one comment very quick. You presented a very good thing, but I forgot the question. I'll ask later. Thank you.
Can I just...
Does anybody have a question rather than a comment to do with the conference?
Alia, just a minute. About the drainage system, the transport system of Karachi has been studied to death. There are reasons why it has not been carried out. But as far as the drainage is concerned, let me tell you the reason for the Karachi flooding is simply that the outfalls to the sea have been blocked. There is no exit to the sea. They have been encroached upon by the Defense Society, which has made plots in Phase 7, which was the main exit of water for a very large part of Karachi. The other is the KPT colony on my Karachi bypass that is blocking 3 main nalas that drained Karachi out into the sea. The third is Machhar colony's land grabbing and extension into the sea, in which I think every Karachi administration has been involved in. So this is the reason why Karachi floods.
I think only these last, oh, you have one. All right. And then we'll come to the front. Okay?
Okay. So my question is very short, and it can be for anybody. You talk about the Karachi Museum. Can you comment on how you want to go about persuading, or is there interest by the common man for such an endeavor? Because as some just pointed out, there are other things that the
Well, as far as the interest is concerned, well, everybody is concerned and they have the interest. I see a lot of people coming to my museum and they are very much interested in their heritage and history. And as Dr. Lashari was mentioned, the previous museum, the whole collection is lying down in the National Museum of Pakistan. And if we want to open a museum of Karachi, we can just display that in the first phase. So this whole collection is getting spoiled in the reserves of National Museum of Pakistan, and I opened it for some time, got it clean and digitized. So that is not an issue. We just need a building. We are there to put it up.
I think a city museum is really something that can change the socio-cultural fabric of a city, and citizens do get involved because it becomes a hub, especially for school children and so on, and that within a generation does change. It brings change and involvement with heritage. The gentleman here, and then I think we'll have to end.
I was involved with some people who were making a children's museum. Romana was part of it. In fact, the foundation tree was, or something was planted. It fell by the wayside, partly because the land we were given was given to us by General Musharraf, I believe. And also, but there was a lot of enthusiasm and a lot of stuff went in and money and donations were given. And I'm very sad that that happened. It could be part of a Karachi museum. It doesn't have to be separate, but it was an idea that suddenly fell.
This gentleman has been waiting for a while, and that will be our last question.
Thank you. My name is Nizamuddin. I do write columns on conflict. My question is brief, and it may be a raw and wild question. I am asking from all the learned speakers not to be optimist, not to be pessimist, just to be realistic. How we see Karachi 15 years down the road? A Beirut, God forbid, a Delhi, a Singapore.
Pakistan gold and copper, Central Asian trade, the Indian Ocean navigation, where 70% of all oil moves across from the Cape of Hormuz to the Capes of Straits of Malacca. Now all this, if there is peace, if there is vision, it will make Karachi a very great city. But I think before that, we will have to pay a heavy price to solve the issues and problems that the city faces today.
Thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, please do visit the Karachi Conference website. Aisha, what is the exact address?
It's KarachiConference.com.
KarachiConference.com. Thank you for being here, and thank you to all my colleagues.